associated with the ARPANET thing. Having been at BBN for about a year, I had cast around for something that was suitable for me to do, and I worked for a while in a P10 group working on a time-sharing system, but I basically didn't believe in that. So Frank was trying to figure out what to do, what I might do, and he gave me a copy of the RFP from ARPA for the net and said, well, why don't you take a look at this and see what you think of it. It wasn't clear at all what he thought of it at that point. I took it home and I read it. And it looked to me as though it was something that could be built all right, but I couldn't understand why one would want such a thing, and I said the same to Frank the next day, and of course that gives some clue as to my ability to predict how things will go.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our host for this evening, President and Chief Executive Officer of BBN, Mr. George Conrades.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, 5 years ago, Severo asked a darn good question. Who would want such a thing indeed? What was the idea behind the ARPANET, and who were the people that wanted to build it in the first place? Those people were instrumental in writing the history of the future, the ARPANET pioneers. And it is to honor them and their remarkable achievements that we've gathered here tonight. On behalf of Bolt, Beranek, and Newman, I'm pleased to welcome all of you to the history of the future, ARPANET, Internet, and beyond, a celebration of 25 years of innovation in network communications. The history of our future began in the 1960s. It was a decade that saw the Beatles, Bell Bottom Pants, Peter Max and Op Art, John Kennedy, Apollo 11 on the moon, Woodstock, and the Miracle Mets. It was also the decade of a visionary named J.C.R. Licklider, a psychologist by training. Who came to specialize in the interaction between people and computers. Licklider was well ahead of his time. He imagined a world where people using computers could communicate across a room, a campus, an entire city. Indeed, at a time when computers were monoliths sitting in air-conditioned rooms, he envisioned a computer network enabling people to communicate with each other around the globe. It was the hard work of dozens of other pioneers working in the light of Licklider's vision who really made that vision a reality. Well, just who were those early pioneers? They were engineers and managers and government and university researchers. Some of them were brilliant theoreticians. Others had the special talent for taking theory and turning it into something real. A rare team came together, and all of them had a profound effect on history and on our lives. Pioneers like Bob Kahn, Larry Roberts, Bob Taylor. But you shouldn't be hearing all of this from me. Let's listen to a few of those pioneers now.
Well, there was a mixed crew. When I first arrived at BBN, the group that I was working with actually was a somewhat nerdy group. There were a number of MIT dropouts, and you know, people walked the halls in some cases without shoes and socks. There were dogs in the building. There were bicycles in the building. People played musical instruments during the day sometimes.
Well, Frank was concerned about how this would appear in Washington when we went down to make the presentation. And so he had me get on the phone to Will. Everyone else was standing around and tell Will that it was really important to wear shoes. So I did that, as Frank requested, knowing full well what was going to happen. Will said, you tell Frank that they've seen my sneakers in JSAC meetings and it'll be all right. And indeed it was.
Well, Ben and I were friends from high school. He was a half a year ahead. High school in Los Angeles was a three-year affair, so I came in 10th grade and bumped into Vint pretty early, and we got to be pretty good friends. We'd pal around, spend weekends together working on odd projects. building 3D chess games or trying to recreate Edwin Land's experiments with color perception. It was sort of two teenage boys who were, you know, not getting in trouble, but just sort of really focused on one project after another.
One of the problems was that UCLA tended to be locked up pretty much on the weekends. So Crocker and I would go on Saturday, and we would climb up to the third floor, scaling the windows to get up to the third floor to get in, so that we could run the programs on the computer. And actually, to this day, I don't know whether we actually were had permission to do that or not, but we sure had a good time.
It used to drive me crazy. You know, I would go up on a trip with Lenny and with Larry, and these guys like to work puzzles. And I'd be sitting in the back of the car or the front of the car, and they'd be saying, what happens if a man on a boat drops his hat into the stream and the water is running down at this rate, and the bird comes and he lands on the hat, but the bird is flying and accelerates something. And I said, I only solve problems for money.
There I am, 2 a.m, late at night, tired as a dog, all alone in this machine. And you know, when you're alone with the machine at night, you listen to all the sounds. And if any sound is wrong, you pick it up immediately and you're worried you're gonna break something. I'm working there, and all of a sudden I hear, psst, a strange, windy sound. And my heart jumped, because I knew something was about to go wrong. And I couldn't find out what it was, so I was looking around. Finally, my eyes scanned the console, and there in an empty space, I saw 2 eyes looking at me. Son of a bitch, Larry Roberts.
Well, just a note for Vince Cerf. Severo told me that you did have permission to work at UCLA on the weekends. You could have just walked in the front door instead of scaling all those windows. One of the pioneers, Bob Taylor, the psychologist who was working with Licklider at the time, came up with an old-fashioned common sense idea. He asked himself a simple question. Why have a bunch of computer scientists work on independent, isolated computers when they could be sharing their resources? Well, Taylor faced some big challenges. He was thinking about doing something completely unheard of. But despite that challenge, he knew how to get what he needed. Let's listen.
In 1964, through 69, I was at ARPA in their computer research program called Information Processing Techniques. Now, in ARPA's offices, in my offices when I was there, I had terminals to each of these 3 ARPA-supported time-sharing systems, one at MIT, one at System Development Corporation Santa Monica, one at Berkeley. 3 different terminals. I had them because I could go up to any one of these terminals and log in to the terminal and then be connected to the community of people in each one of these 3 places. But it was immediately obvious once you saw that there were these 3 different terminals to these 3 distinct places that the obvious question would come to anyone's mind, why don't we just have a network such that we have 1 terminal and we can just go anywhere we want? So in February of 66, I went into the director of ARPA's office, Charlie Hertzfeld, and told him about this idea. And he liked it right away. And after about 20 minutes, he took $1 million out of someone else's budget, I don't know who to this day, and put it in my budget and say, great, get started. Since ARPA was going into a different mode in this particular project, in the ARPANET project, where it was taking initiative and actually running things in a more direct way, we needed new kinds of resources in the office that we didn't have up until then. I needed a program manager, and I needed a contracts administrator. And I had talked with Larry Roberts in 1965 about the ARPANET. He liked the idea. In February of 66, after I had gotten the money to go ahead and continue the project in a full-fledged way, I asked him to come down and be the program manager for the project, and he wasn't interested. He wanted to stay at Lincoln Lab and do research. He didn't want to become, I think, what he saw as a fundamentally a job of being a Washington bureaucrat. So I tried all during 66 to try to get him to change his mind, and I continually failed. Then in October or November of 66, I had an idea, and I went in to see Charlie Hertzfeld again, the director of ARPA. And I said, Charlie, is it true that ARPA supports 51% of Lincoln Lab?
Bob, as he likes to tell, finally arranged to get me to come to ARPA through somewhat of a blackmailing arrangement.
I said, would you call the director of Lincoln Lab and tell him that it would be in Lincoln Lab's best interest and Larry Roberts' best interest if the director of Lincoln Lab would convince Larry to come down and take this job?
Well, they forced me to come. I wasn't too anxious to step into management at that point.
Charlie smiled and said, sure, and he picked up the phone while I was in his office, and he called Jerry Dineen at Lincoln Lab, and I heard Charlie's end of the conversation. It was a short conversation, and 2 weeks later, Larry accepted the job.
What they wanted me to do was take on the program in general, but also in particular to develop the communications program and get a network program running, which I undertook to do. Now, with that funding, I could, in fact, go out and create the network that I thought should be created. The result was we had a design, went out on bid, and got Bolt Beranek and Newman to do the design of the switch. They built the switch, and the network started to happen.
Well, the next time I think I need to get something done, I'm going to go to Bob Taylor. In any event, BBN was awarded the job to develop the ARPANET, beating out more than a dozen prospective companies. BBN was given 9 months to build the equipment that would make the ARPANET possible. That is 9 months of labor to give birth to an IMP, otherwise known as an interface message processor built from a Honeywell computer. The IMP was to be the messenger between computers at all the host sites. Its job was to divide messages into packets, send them across the network to their destinations. Nothing quite like it had ever been built. Let's hear about that now.
We were very confident that we could do it. People at that point who were at BBN loved intellectual challenges. I mean, there were people that lived and breathed on intellectual challenges. In fact, that was better than food and drink to many of them. I was running the project. I was kind of the principal investigator of the contract, and in charge of getting the proposal written, and then in charge of the project. Well, we were very concerned about reliability. I think that my background at Lincoln had been working on a Whirlwind computer and on a Sage system, and there was a guy there who was in charge of those projects named Jay Forrester, who was very, very, very concerned about reliability. And so I carried that concern with me, and as did some of the other people that came from Lincoln. And we were therefore anxious to do anything we possibly could to make the machine stay working. And that's not such an easy problem, because if you think about it, these were supposed to be unattended. They were supposed to run for a long period without anybody touching them. They were supposed to run in faraway places where we couldn't get at them very easily. So we actually used ruggedized hardware. It was not really mil-spec, but it was very close to mil-spec. And we paid a penalty of perhaps 10% in the hardware to do that. And then we put a lot of energy into various things to allow us to remotely figure out how the little devil was feeling. We viewed the imps at that point as children to be very, very carefully tended. And we airshipped that imp, and people went down to the airport and held its hand until it was physically taken from the truck onto the dolly and from the dolly onto the airplane. And we were there at the other end to watch it being unloaded from the airplane, because we viewed it as very critical that it arrive in one piece. And people who carry boxes around the country aren't necessarily notable for being so incredibly careful. We wanted to be very sure that they saw people watching and were therefore extra careful. So that was a very important thing to us, to get it to UCLA on time. And it probably got there somewhat ahead of their expectations.
BBN debugged the hardware and was worried about making the deadline, so they put it on an airplane and shipped it. I'd been thinking that because of their troubles and because of the time it would take to install it, and that Honeywell, who made the machine, would send a team in, and then BBN would send a hardware team in, and then BBN would send a software team in, that I probably had 2 weeks of grace in this.
First of all, me and my team were there. We had the people from the UCLA administration there. I mean, after all, you're going to use our university. BBN was there. ARPA was there. Of course, Honeywell was there. The people who built my host machine, the system, scientific data systems was there. We had AT&T long lines there. We're going to use their lines. We had GTE. We're going to use their local access. Everybody that could be there was there, and they're all ready to point the accusing finger at the other guy.
So the machine showed up on our loading dock on Saturday at the end of August on Labor Day weekend and was rolled into our machine room and plugged in and started working right from where the program had stopped when they unplugged it in Cambridge. And it was still Saturday, and my 2 weeks of grace became minus 2 days, and so we were in trouble and needed to work very hard to get everything working.
This first installation at UCLA inspired a new way of thinking about networks. It has inspired a new era in the relationship between computers and communications. It inspired a new direction for the information age. And let us never forget, it also inspired some epic poetry. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Len Kleinrock, ARPANET Poet Laureate.
I'm constrained to stick to the script. The Big Bang. It was back in 67, the Klan agreed to meet. The gangsters and the planners were a breed hard, damned hard to beat. The goal we set was honest, and the need was clear to all. Connect those big old mainframes and the minis, lest they fall. The spec went out to bidders, and 'twas won by BBN. They worked on soft and hardware, and they all got paid for fun. We decided UCLA would be the first node on the net. As the best researchers out there, we would be the perfect bet. I suspect you might be asking, what means first node on the net? Well, frankly, it meant trouble, especially since no specs were set. For you see, the interface between the nascent IMP and host was a confidential secret from us folks on the West Coast. BBN had promised that the IMP was running late. We welcomed any slippage in the deadly scheduled date. But one day after Labor Day was plopped down at our gate, those dirty, rotten scoundrels sent the damned thing out air freight. As I recall that Tuesday, it makes me want to cry. Everybody's brother came to blame the other guy. Folks were there from ARPA, BBN and Honeywell, UCLA and ATT, and all were scared as hell. We cautiously connected, and the bits began to flow. The pieces really functioned, just why I still don't know. Messages were moving pretty well by Wednesday morn. All the rest is history. Packet switching had been born.
Thank you, Len. That was truly inspiring and informational. Soon after the UCLA installation, other sites were added to the net, including Santa Barbara, Menlo Park, and Salt Lake City. Under the leadership of Doug Engelbart, an early thinker in such areas as human-computer interaction and collaboration using computers, one of the original contractors, SRI, was implementing a Network Information Center, or NIC. The NIC's purpose was to provide information on the resources that were available to the network. In fact, by 1971, there were 15 fully operational nodes in the ARPANET. But it wasn't until 1972 that the network had its big public premiere. In 1972, Hair was still shocking audiences on Broadway. Richard Nixon was reelected. Watergate was about to become the talk of the town, and the Vietnam War was still raging in Southeast Asia. And in the shadow of these events, 1972 also saw the gathering of hundreds of computer scientists for a demonstration at the Washington, D.C. Hilton Hotel. They came from across the country to witness the first public demonstration of the technology that would write the history of the future. There were some amusing little anecdotes that came out of that event.
In many ways, the unsung hero of that 1972 demonstration is Al Bezza from MIT. Al never really got the visible recognition, but he and I worked very, very closely on putting that demonstration together. It involved bringing together some 40 terminal manufacturers, establishing an ARPANET node in the Hilton. And in fact, the timetable on which we actually had to do the installation was something like 6 hours to get the phone lines in, to get the machines up before the thing actually opened up. And Al just did a tour de force in managing the whole crew to do that. It took us about, I would say, close to a year to actually plan and carry out that demonstration. And the significance of the demonstration was that it was the first really forceful push to make the ARPANET useful to the end users.
A lot of them came to Washington to do the final preparation. So in the few days just before this thing opened, there's a huge ballroom floor, terminals all over the place, wires everywhere, people working feverishly. And funny little anecdotes would happen. Two guys would be interacting. One guy would be logged in to the University of Utah, and he would see that somebody else was logged in at the University of Utah that he knew. And so he would connect to him through the computer in Utah and have some conversation, thinking that he was in Utah. Well, one guy would say, well, where are you? And the other guy would say, well, I'm in Washington. Where are you in Washington? Well, I'm at the Hilton. Well, I'm at the Hilton, too. And the two guys would turn out to be, a few feet or across the hall from each other, and they'd have to try to describe how they were going to find each other. They'd never seen each other, never talked to each other before. And their interactions are going through this machine in Utah and back and forth.
We had one guy who was from the Institute for the Future. I can't even remember his name now, Hubert something, but anyway. He sat down in front of the terminal and, typed, I forgot what now, but, something to cause it to open the connection to the machine on the other side of the net. And for some reason or other, the network had partitioned or that host wasn't functioning or whatever, and the message came up, host dead. Now, this guy took that to mean took the biological interpretation of that, and he said, oh my God, I've killed it. And he wouldn't touch the terminal anymore after that. He was convinced that he'd done some awful thing.
But it was exciting because it was the first time the whole community had shown up in one place at one time. If somebody had dropped a bomb on the Washington Hilton, it would have destroyed almost all of the networking community in the United States at that point. On the other hand, the people who attended that knew very little about networking or the net, I think were in many cases astonished about not only what it could do, but the fact that it worked at all. It really put packet switching on the map, in my opinion.
Now, the ARPANET had a lot more believers, but the team of intrepid innovators still had many problems to solve. How could users know what resources were available on the network? As the network expanded, would messages circle forever and never get to their destination? Given all the potential traffic on the network, data, routing updates, acknowledgments, would the network work, or would it be brought to its knees like the Santa Monica Freeway during a rush hour? Meanwhile, the pioneers were still at work on some of these and other problems. When it comes to integrating computers into a network, there are basically three things that you have to worry about. Laying it out in such a way that allows for smooth growth, measuring and controlling the flow of information across the network, and building and maintaining a directory of the resources that are available to the network. Howard Frank at the Network Analysis Center, Len Kleinrock with the Network Measurement Center at UCLA, and Doug Engelbart with the Network Information Center took on these jobs.
First time I heard of ARPANET. Well, for some reason or another, I met Larry Roberts, and I met him in 1968. At the time, I was working in government also. I'd come from a year from on leave from Berkeley. And somehow I met Larry, and I thought it was kind of oddball. And I thought he was looking for money, which I didn't have. And so I was trying to defend myself, and I basically think I ignored him. I must have ignored him because I didn't see him again for about a year. We had just formed this company. Nobody had ever heard of us. On the other hand, we had formed the company because we had just had a very successful one-year stay in the executive office of the President of the United States, demonstrating that network technology could be applied to real-world problems. And we had done something very strange. Actually, it's bizarre if you think about our backgrounds. We had applied some academic theoretical technologies and computer technology to the problem of designing offshore natural gas pipeline networks. Now, frankly, at the time, I had never even seen an offshore natural gas pipeline network. In fact, I still may have never seen one. I've seen films of them subsequently to that. Most of my guys cooked with gas, and that's as close as they ever got to it. And yet we had been able to come up with a mathematical and computer discipline that could optimize those networks irrespective of the material that they were transporting. And so Larry made this intuitive, inductive leap that said if they can optimize a gas pipeline network and they can optimize a different kind of network, then maybe what they can do is they can do the same thing for a computer communications network. And indeed, he was right.
Now, Howie at that time was involved in networking things as well. He was involved with topological design procedures, where to put lines in a network. What kind of a topological structure do you want? I was concerned with related issues. I would take a problem example. If you give me a network with a certain topology, how will it perform? And if you change the topology, how will it perform? Howie was more focused on showing what the topology should look like.
In the context of ARPANET, what was going on was that people were working individually, okay, quite often using their own sort of view of the Earth. Okay, Len as a modeling view, for instance, trying to measure things and extrapolate using theory. Bob Kahn's view of the Earth was we're gonna build it and see if it works, okay, and then see how it works. And I was off doing topological design, network design, that is, and trying to build models which then could be extrapolated to the large-scale systems that couldn't be built yet. And we discovered we were really working on different aspects of the same problem and coming up with the same conclusions, which is interesting because truth is truth. It shows you could find different ways of getting at the same kind of truth.
After years of work, through the diligent application of their science, these researchers were able to turn a 15-node network into, well, see what I mean? The original network grew out of the ideas and innovations of a number of proud pioneers. Many of these pioneers have honored us tonight with their presence. Now we would like to take a few moments to honor them. It's my pleasure to bring back to the podium a man who was an employee at BBN back in 1969 and was in position to witness the development of the ARPANET, a man who wishes to pay personal tribute to the people who made the history of the future possible. Ladies and gentlemen, the chairman of the board of Bolt Beranek and Newman and a visionary in his own right, Mr. Steve Levy. Steve?
Thank you, George. As George mentioned, I've been around through a lot of this. Why, I remember receiving a letter from the then junior senator from Massachusetts, Ted Kennedy. He was congratulating us on the development of the interfaith message processor. We've come a very long way indeed. Just yesterday, our governor declared September 10th, today, Communications Network Day in Massachusetts, and I'd like to read his proclamation. Massachusetts is a world leader in computing and communications, and whereas Massachusetts has the highest concentration of communication equipment manufacturers in the nation, and whereas Massachusetts companies have made pioneering advances in computer networking techniques such as packet switching and ATM, now, therefore, I, William F. Weld, Governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim September 10th, 1994, as Communications Networking Day, and urge all citizens of the Commonwealth to take cognizance of this event and participate fittingly in its observance. The 70s and 80s were an exciting time in computing and communications fields. On the heels of the 1968 Carter phone case, when the FCC ruled that non-ATT equipment could be attached to AT&T lines, the communications industry entered an explosive era of growth. Everyone was extremely excited about this new technology called packet switching. Many believe that it was the beginning of a true paradigm shift in communications technology, and they were right. Some of us saw packet switching technology as an opportunity to build a new kind of communication service business. For example, BBN started Telenet. TimeNet was created. And at the same time, we watched the ARPANET grow. And many of us were surprised by the way it seemed to catch on. The biggest initial impact was on the scientific community. For many computer scientists, the ARPANET was a second home. A connection to the network became indispensable to computer scientists, much so as a microscope is to a biologist. Researchers accepted or declined job offers at universities according to whether that university was on the ARPANET. The network spawned many things. Very soon after the installation of the first four nodes, the first electronic mail messages were sent across the network. A new way of communicating was created, and the communications world also felt the impact. Larry Roberts, then president of Telenet, was convinced that a worldwide standard for packet switching was going to be critical to its rapid diffusion. Larry took a leadership role in convincing the CCITT to adopt an international standard for packet switching, which became known as X25, and he did it in record time. The creation of this standard helped to spawn new commercial versions of the ARPANET. Public data networks were developed in many of the European countries, in Canada, and in the US by AT&T and the Bell operating companies. Major providers of telecommunications equipment such as Siemens and Northern Telecom and BBN started commercial packet switching ventures so that corporations could build their own ARPANETs. An entire new industry of data networking was created. Then came the internet.
I knew that for computers on one network to talk to computers on another network, we would have to understand how to link the networks together and how to make it possible for computers on both ends to talk to each other. That meant developing a methodology to do that because these networks were all different. They had different data rates, they had different packet formats, they had different error structures, error control, different methodologies, and that's what led to the development of the TCP/IP protocol suite as a method for that. This was an effort that Vint Cerf and I collaborated on. Vint had been originally involved in the early NCP efforts along with Steve Crocker and a number of other people. And so Vint was very knowledgeable about both the original host protocol development for the ARPANET and the requirements of the machines to house it.
I can remember, you know, sitting in a hotel in San Francisco waiting for some conference session to start, you know, scratching literally on the back of an envelope some ideas about, you know, how this might be done. And the evolution then was pretty, looking back on it, you can see exactly what was happening. We had three different kinds of networks. They were all packet switched. We agreed we couldn't change the networks inside, so we had to do something outside of the nets that would allow them to be bound together. So we invented the idea of a gateway that could connect two different kinds of nets together and would hide the fact that they were different. Host computers that would be plugged in the different networks would operate an internet protocol that would be common everywhere, including at the gateways. And so we would encapsulate the internet packets at the host inside of whatever the network protocol was, and then pop it back out of its package when it got to a gateway and say, what do I do with this? And push it back into the next net, encapsulate it, like wrapping it up in another envelope. So you can almost think of this as like a post office analogy. And it really, we chose the simplest possible requirements for making the system work. You know, just take this chunk of bits and get them from here to there. We don't even ask you to do it 100%. You know, just do your best to get these bits from point A to point B. Sort of like a postcard. You know, toss a postcard into the mail service and it might make it and it might not. If you throw in seven of them, they don't make it in the same order if you got to put them back together. Those are the kinds of things that were ground rules for the internet design. And it served us tremendously well, because over a period of 20 years, even though all the networks that were used to build the internet, the ARPANET, the packet radio net, and the packet satellite net are long since gone, their history, the internet survives.
The internet has been cast in some unexpected roles, and one of them is that of the conduit for human rights activities. When students demonstrating in Tiananmen Square in 1989 needed garbage bags, messages went up over the internet, read by thousands of Chinese students at the University of California. Nearly 2,000 bags were bought at a store near San Francisco Airport and sent by courier to Beijing. The internet did its part in chipping away at the Cold War during the Soviet coup attempt in Moscow in the summer of 1991. Messages over the internet did a better job of informing the world of what was happening than most other media. And today, human rights organizations are embracing electronic mail as a means of communicating with members around the world, while the network is becoming a global repository for banned and censored writings. The impact of this technology on human endeavor has been remarkable. So much so that earlier this year, Bob Kahn received the Marconi Award, a prestigious international award in the field of communication. Bob was awarded this award for his fundamental contributions to the ARPANET and its successor, the Internet. Please join me in recognizing Bob for all of his achievement. Bob, would you please stand? Another individual whom I would like to recognize tonight is a man who helped BBN contribute to the creation of the ARPANET. Frank Hart managed the BBN team that built the IMP, and thus he helped to shepherd BBN into the age of computer networking. Frank retired this year from his management position after 28 years at BBN. I have worked with him for all of those years, and for all of those years he has been both a colleague and a personal friend. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Frank Hart.
So what the heck's the use of crying?
Why should we curse?
We gotta get better.
Cause we can't get worse.
Add to add to it.
Thanks very much, Steve. That's a very nice welcome. Music is terrific. It's quite a pleasure to be here tonight, helping to celebrate a success story. A success story which is changing the world in what I think is a positive way. It's well known that failures are orphans and success has many fathers. And I'm very pleased to be one of the people claiming sort of partial fatherhood of this success. I thought that since a lot of large and small projects are not so successful, I'd like to spend just a few moments mentioning some of the factors that I think went into what ended up being the success of the ARPANET project, kind of as a project. First, locally at BBN, as well as at the early host sites, the work was being performed by a very, very small group of very talented people. All the hardware people could program. All the software people were convinced they knew more about the hardware than the hardware people. We had an unusually strong group, including Will Crowther, who was the person who also was the first inventor of adventure games, Dave Walden, Severo Ornstein, Ben Barker, Holy Rising, and Bob Kahn. Bob, as Steve has mentioned, went on from his early days in the participation in the project to BBN to play a key role at ARPA in the development of the ARPANET and the Internet. If projects can be staffed with small, talented groups, it's a great way to go. It really is. Second, there was a really enlightened and very smart government client, both individually in the form of Larry Roberts and institutionally in the form of ARPA. Further, ARPA was funding both the construction of the network and the research groups that were trying to use the network. That made it somewhat easier to get cooperation. There were strong incentives to cooperation. I think another thing that that leads to is the comment that anything that could be done in our government to make it easier to attract and keep strong program managers would be really nice. The way the laws are set up now, it's really tough for the government to get strong people. It's tough because of all kinds of rules and laws, and it would be nice if that were improved, because it makes a huge difference. Then, despite the fact that the ARPANET was a government project, and despite the fact that it was a Defense Department project, it was amazingly free of the constraints that often are associated with these kinds of support. The project was entirely unclassified. Network services on the ARPANET were provided for a very long time as a free good. It meant that people didn't have to make either ill-advised or hasty cost-benefit decisions. That made a huge difference in whether people were willing to try to use the network and experiment with it for this and that. And despite very deeply ingrained government concern and DOD concern about unauthorized use of government property, unauthorized use of government facilities, we didn't have to worry about complex access controls, complex login procedures, complex accounting to figure out who was doing what. It was amazingly free of those kinds of constraints, and it, of course, made a huge difference. Also, luckily, the ARPANET didn't have to be backward compatible with 50 years of prior communication systems. One could decide what the protocols were supposed to be, and even though Lenin's complained that we didn't maybe decide quite fast enough, it was possible to decide how the hosts were going to communicate to the IMPs and not have to worry about making it backward compatible. In sum, the project was a really interesting example of what can be accomplished quickly with a really strong, sophisticated leadership, adequate resources, an undeviating focus on the main issues, and somehow an avoidance of all the many possible kinds of bureaucratic foolishness that affect so many projects. Well, I'm not going to take very much longer. Nostalgia is a very powerful drug, and I admit to being very high on this drug tonight. Only a very small fraction of the technically trained population get a shot at riding a rocket, the early launch of a technological revolution, and then to see that revolution change the world. This certainly isn't the only one, but it's one of a very small number. And I've come to believe, as others have, that the networking revolution will rank among a very small number of the most important technological changes of the century. So it's been a lot of fun to be here, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Frank. While the ARPA network concept was being developed in the U.S., another team was working on packet switching at the National Physical Laboratory in the U.K. Roger Scantlebury has traveled from the U.K. to be with us tonight, representing the NPL packet pioneers. Roger, please stand and be recognized. I'm also especially pleased tonight to be able to introduce to you two of the founding board members of BBN. Sam Labate, Sam is here. And Jordan Baruch. Jordan? I had hoped that Dick Bolt would be able to make it tonight, but I don't see him. Tonight, we're honored to have here Louise Licklider with us at this dinner, and since her late husband, affectionately known to all of us as Lick, worked at BBN from 1957 to 1961, we think of Louise as part of our BBN extended family. Please join me in recognizing her. Louise Licklider. George Conrades and I sincerely appreciate the fact that so many of you who worked on the ARPANET project have taken the time to be with us here tonight. A few days ago, we received a letter from the White House, which I would like to read to you. I am delighted to greet everyone gathered in Boston to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the creation of the ARPANET. A quarter of a century ago, when a small group of scientists set out to teach computers to talk to one another, few of us could have imagined the technological revolution that lay in store. Yet today, that simple idea has transformed our society and hastened the dawning of the information age. Across vast oceans in a matter of seconds, professionals in all fields can transmit volumes of facts and figures to colleagues around the globe. Students have instant access to vast libraries of knowledge, and hospitals can retrieve invaluable patient data at the touch of a button. From business and government to academia and the arts, computer networking has strengthened our nation and empowered our people immeasurably. Bringing together visionary individuals from every area of society, the ARPANET project stands as a testament to the brilliant achievements that can result when the public and private sectors work together for the common good. As one of the millions of people around the world who stays in touch through the internet, the direct descendant of the ARPANET, I extend gratitude and deep admiration to the pioneering scientists who have made computer networking a reality. You have changed the way we think and communicate, and you can take tremendous pride in knowing that the full promise of your vision has only begun to be fulfilled. Best wishes to all for a most enjoyable celebration. And it is signed, Bill Clinton. I'd like to ask all of the pioneers to stand up and receive a well-deserved round of applause.
Well, as Steve mentioned, the history of the ARPANET led to the internet, which will in turn lead to beyond. It's been 25 years since the first IMP was installed at UCLA. Now the internet spans the globe. Millions of people log on to this mother of all networks. It keeps growing and evolving. It's spreading faster than cellular phones or fax machines. In fact, some estimates report that the internet is growing at the rate of 20% per month. And perhaps most importantly, advances such as Mosaic, an information browsing program that works at the click of a mouse, have greatly simplified its use. Click on a mouse and you're seeing weather photos taken from a satellite. Click again and you're inside the card catalog of the Library of Congress. Click again and you're seeing a picture of a medieval manuscript at the Vatican. But don't take my word for it. Let's take a moment to hear about the internet and its future by some experts who are truly in a position to know.
My name is Emma Stickold, and if you're looking for me on the internet, you'll find me as zero, which is not my IQ number.
Well,
The reason that the internet has attracted many younger people is because adults tend to like, you know, TV better, because the internet involves, you know, everything. You know, it involves, you know, using your mind, which younger people tend to enjoy more than older people.
I would say that internet has changed my life. I just say it makes it something to do when I'm bored.
I'd rather do internet because I get to actually be with my friends on internet. And if I'm going fishing, I can only be with a couple of my friends, but on internet, I can be with all of them at once.
Well, one thing I like to improve about the internet is the cost of everything. Because if you're just a kid and you know, your friends are all into the internet and you'd like to go explore to see what it is, and you ask your parents, you know, can we get a computer with a modem and a phone line hookup to get on the internet? And they say, oh, well, how much does it cost? And you say, oh, a computer costs about $1,500 and a modem costs $60. And they say, oh, no, that's way out of the price range.
There's a girl I know, and she has a boyfriend on internet, and I don't know if he's still her boyfriend, but as far as I know, he could be completely ugly, and yet he's still her boyfriend because they talk to each other on the internet. And they create posters on the internet about, like, Sphere loves Dynamite and Dynamite loves Sphere.
I just like talking to people. You know, people want, because, you know, people that think higher than me, and they give me some information, like, about school. When I was in school, I was having some trouble with, you know, the work and stuff. So I was talking to one person, and he gave me some information on what I should do, you know. And he said that, you know, you are ahead of a lot of people because of your age and what grade you're in, and you should be proud of that.
Our parents, they're used to using telephones and watching TV instead of using the telephone and TV sort of mixed together. My mom was the one who got the computer, but I'm the one who uses it mostly. She does business stuff on it, but she doesn't use the modem a lot. I was showing it to my parents last night, and they weren't really interested, but of course this was like 10 o'clock at night.
The reason I think the net is really cool is because, you know, you get to create your worlds of your own. You get to build up social skills, physical skills. Your fingers get really tired, I have to tell you, but it's worth it. The internet, you know, I laugh a lot. It's really funny because a lot of the stuff people say is funny. So if someone was watching me, they'd see me giggle.
I think the internet is going to go very commercialized soon because you can already see it happening and stuff. Like, you can see a web server somewhere where you can order a pizza or something. There's a Pizza Hut web server somewhere. You enter your home phone number and your name, and then... So I think eventually the internet is just gonna become a big commercialized thing. Then they're just gonna have to make a new network for public use.
For the guys who are the ARPANET pioneers, I'd have to say that they're pretty geniuses, because 25 years ago, no one would have ever thought of anything like this. Most people didn't even own a computer. So people would never have thought of computers through the phone lines. And I think to just even imagine that, not even to create it, but even to imagine it, you have to be a genius.
Well, I couldn't say it any better myself. You pioneers are geniuses, and I stand in awe and gratitude and appreciation. Please join me again in a hearty round of applause for the ARPANET pioneers. Thank you all for being here tonight. That's the end of our event. Please enjoy one another, have a safe ride home, and thank you again for coming. Good night, all.